magnificent Holy Father. I stand in awe of all I see, of all the things you have created, and still you choose to think of me. And who am I that you should suffer? Your very life to set me free. The only thing that I can give you is the life you gave to me. This is my offering. This is my offering to you, God. I will give you my life, for it's all I have to give. Because you gave your life for me. Stand before you at this altar. So many have given you more. I may not have much I can offer, yet what I have is truly yours. This is my offering. This is my offering to you, God. I will give you my life, for it's all I have to give. Because you gave your life for me. This is my offering, dear Lord. This is my offering to you, God. I will give you my life, for it's all I have to give. Because you gave your life for me.
Good morning. It is beautiful out. We are going to read Psalm 122, so if you want to turn your Bibles to that, that'd be great. As you're doing that, the announcements this morning, there is a roadside cleanup next Saturday. Join us at 8 a.m. for hot dogs in the ditch. Don't eat them. You don't know what you'll find out there. So we're going to join at 8 a.m., so let's go clean the ditch. It's something that we do for our community, and it's just a great time to hang out together as well. Also upcoming, VBS, June 10th through the 14th. See Becky about that. There's a church picnic Saturday, June 22nd, at the home of Mark and Leanne Anfinson. Will there be hot dogs there too? More information on that to come. If you're a visitor, please fill this out. We want to know who you are. We want to reach out to you and serve you. We love that you're here. For those joining us online, thank you as well. Come see us if you're online only. You'll like most of us. Ready? Psalm 122. I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Our feet have been standing within your gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem, built as a city that is bound firmly together, to which the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, as was decreed for Israel, to give thanks to the name of the Lord. There, thrones for judgment were set, the thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they be secure who love you. Peace be within your walls and security within your towers. For my brothers and companions' sake, I will say, peace be within you. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your good. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for allowing us to serve you, to come together, God, in worship in this house of the Lord. Thank you, thank you. Peace be within your walls, Lord, within your towers, and for our own sake, Lord. Peace be within you. What a great word, Lord. Peace be within you. Be with us this day. Open our hearts, our minds, Lord, to hear you, to see you, to serve you, Lord, in mighty ways. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen. Let's stand and lift our voices in praise to our great God.
God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation. A love song born of a grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gather underground. With all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. With all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, it's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, and all the powers of darkness tremble at what they've just heard. Cause all the powers of darkness, they can't drown out a single word. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns. Glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. He reigns, it's all God's children singing glory, glory.
God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for the opportunity to gather in this place. Lord, we praise you and give you all the glory. I ask now that you open our hearts and minds as we continue to worship you through the preaching of the word, that we might hear what you have to say to us today. Again, we give you the glory. Pray that your will be done in Jesus' name. Amen. Take a second and say howdy to your neighbor. Little Force Fellowship.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome again to the Real Tree Church. Happy Mother's Day to all of you mothers out there, wannabe mothers, soon to be mothers, all of that jazz. This Lord's Day, we'll be continuing our study of Matthew's Gospel as we always do, so I invite you to take your Bibles in hand. If you don't have one, there's some in the pews. And turn with us over to chapter 23. We'll be continuing in chapter 23 this morning, considering verses 13 through 22. Chapter 23, verses 13 through 22. Last week in our text, we began this, that is our Lord's final sermon, his final public sermon. He's been debating and refuting the Jewish leadership in this temple setting that we're in now for some time. It probably wasn't that long when it took place, as we've been taking weeks to go over it, but we're in the same setting as we have been for a couple weeks now. And a couple of weeks ago, we saw as our Lord went on the offensive and asked a question to the leadership as to who the Messiah was. Who do they think the Messiah is supposed to be? And they failed that test miserably. They did not answer correctly. And on the heels of that failure, our Lord then begins to condemn the Jewish leadership in public. In public, in the temple setting. For who they truly are, or were. In our text from last week, we saw that Jesus identified them as being all about themselves. They were concerned with receiving the glory and the honor that was meant for God. They had no concern whatsoever for directing the affections, praises, and honor of the people to God. They wanted it for themselves. They wanted the people to notice them. They wanted to be in the place of honor. They wanted to be called rabbi. They wanted everyone to think that they were the most holy and righteous people, righteous men in the land. It was all me, me, me. They were on the throne of their hearts, not God. And our Lord ended our text last week by pointing out that humility and service are the characteristic traits of a true leader. Humility and service. True shepherds of God's people are about the glory of God, not the recognition of men. They're about serving and loving God and serving and loving others. I pray that you've taken some time this week to reflect on your heart, to ask the question of who is sitting on the throne of your heart. Is it you? Or is it the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you do what you do on Sundays and throughout the week for your pleasure, for your entertainment, and for your glory? Or do you do what you do on Sundays and throughout the week because you love God, and because you love others, and because you want to serve them? Those are questions that each of us need to be asking ourselves continually. Not one time, but continually, over and over again. Do we do what we do for God? Or is it all about us? Those are important questions. In our text before us today and over the next couple of weeks, we find some of the harshest and condemning language used by the Lord Jesus Christ in all of Scripture. In fact, it is so harsh that liberal theologians have proposed that, since they believe Jesus to be all love, 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 with nothing more than warm, fuzzy feelings, cuddly puppies, and lollipops, that this part of Matthew's gospel must have then been added later by some zealous scribe. It couldn't have been the Jesus that they propose to know. This simply couldn't have been a Jesus that's so judgmental and divisive. Well, that viewpoint is a bunch of hogwash. False teachers are a serious threat, and our Lord deals with them exactly as they should be dealt with. It's no laughing matter to mislead anyone at any time for any reason, but it's even more serious when that person's eternal destiny is involved, and that is exactly what false teachers are messing with, the eternal destiny of the souls of men. As we will see today and in the weeks to come, that is exactly how our Lord viewed this issue, very seriously. And that's how we should view the issue as well. Let's go now to our text. I invite you to stand with me in reverence for the reading of the Word of the Living God, Matthew chapter 23, beginning in verse 13 and continuing through verse 22. This is our Lord speaking. But woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut the kingdom of heaven in people's faces, for you neither enter yourselves nor allow those who would enter to go in. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you travel across sea and land to make a single proselyte, and when he becomes a proselyte, you make him twice as much a child of hell as yourselves. Woe to you, blind guides, who say, if anyone swears by the temple, it is nothing, but if anyone swears by the gold of the temple, he's bound by his oath. You blind fools! For which is greater, the gold or the temple that has made the gold sacred? And you say, if anyone swears by the altar, it is nothing, but if anyone swears by the gift that is on the altar, he's bound by his oath. You blind men! For which is greater, the gift or the altar that makes the gift sacred? So whoever swears by the altar swears by it and by everything on it. And whoever swears by the temple swears by it and by him who dwells in it. And whoever swears by heaven swears by the throne of God and by him who sits upon it. This is the inerrant, infallible word of the living God. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the opportunity again to gather in this place. And Lord, as we consider these very harsh words of our Lord, help us to understand them. Help us to rightly get what we're supposed to get out of this. Help this knowledge then to get from our head to our heart. Lord, for your glory, help us to make sure that you are sitting on the throne of our hearts and not us. And Father, we pray for those who are here or listening online or those that we know who are lost. Lord, we plead for their souls. We plead for the souls of those who are lost and perishing, and help us be instrumental in leading them to you. God, we love you, praise you, and give you the glory in all things, and pray that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. You can have a seat. As you all are surely aware, tolerance is the issue of the day. Right? Now, I'm sure that you are also aware, and if you're not, you need to be, that the tolerance that we see today only goes one way. If you are a liberal, be that politically or religiously, then your views are to be tolerated at all costs without exception. But if you have a traditional biblical worldview, a view which does not separate the secular from the spiritual, but views all of life as for the glory of God, then under no circumstances are your views to be tolerated. Absolutely not. Sadly, that worldview has bled over into much of Christendom, much of what I will call the so-called church, has adopted the policy of tolerance of all things liberal. Much of Christendom has bought into the idea that doctrine divides and should therefore be jettisoned and ignored in the name of unity. We should all just get along in the name of love, no matter what the other might be preaching or teaching. That viewpoint has swept into many mainline denominations and churches. The liberal secular humanists that dominate the state-run educational systems have now taught for decades that all religions are of equal value. Therefore, don't you dare say anything negative or against any of them, except, of course, biblical Christianity. Now, you can condemn that all you want. If you doubt me in this, then explain to me how Islam can be identified by the talking heads as a religion of peace, when it is directly responsible for the murder of millions of people on an ongoing basis with no end in sight. Even in light of those facts, many, if not most today, will never say a word against Islam or any false religion for that matter. And even worse, most will not dare call out someone who is a false teacher claiming to be a Christian. As we will see today, our Lord had no such qualms about calling out and condemning exactly what he saw. Let's go back now and dig in a bit. Look at verse 13. But woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut the kingdom of heaven in people's faces. For you neither enter yourselves nor allow those who would enter to go in. As we will see today and next week, I had to split it in half, it was too long. Our Lord is going to pronounce a series of woes on the Jewish leadership. Seven, as a matter of fact. And in the Old Testament, the word woe was used to express grief. Woe is me. Despair, sorrow, dissatisfaction, pain, and fear of losing one's life. In the New Testament, it is used to speak of sorrow and of judgment. So over the next couple of weeks, when we see the word woe, know that our Lord is using it to pronounce divine judgment on the religious leaders of that day. Our Lord says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. Woe to you, you false teachers, you phonies, you liars. Why are the scribes and Pharisees hypocrites? Look what he says. Because they shut the kingdom of heaven in people's faces, not entering in themselves or allowing others to enter in. The picture is one of our Lord offering true salvation to the people, to the Jewish people, as in opening this door of eternal life to the people. And these religious leaders, they rush up and they slam the figurative door in the face of those who are about to enter into salvation. Do you see the picture that he's painting there? The scribes and Pharisees, by and large, are not going to enter into salvation. Some do, but most are not. And they are certainly not going to allow anyone else to enter in if they can help it. They are denying the Messiah. They are denying the need for repentance. They are denying salvation by grace. They are slamming the door of eternal life in the faces of those who are perhaps seeking God. This is true of any false religion in the world today as well, because there is nothing new under the sun. There's nothing new under the sun. All the phonies today are just repackaged lies devised by the enemy to attempt to slam the door in the faces of those who are seeking God, those who God is calling to himself. It's the same stuff. This applies to all the well-known and not so well-known cults, as well as the name it, claim it guys you see on TV and the internet, and everything in between. Any so-called church, teacher, or preacher who is teaching anything other than the unadulterated truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, as found in the pages of Scripture, falls into the category that our Lord is condemning in our passage today. Now, before we move on to our next verse, I want you to see how our Lord is handling this. And I want you to make note of it, because it's a recurring theme in this chapter. I want you to notice that Jesus is not being mealy-mouth. Do you see that? He's not pussyfooting around. He's not beating around the bush. He's not worried about hurting someone's feelings or what other people might think of him. And he's certainly not worried about being divisive, because that is exactly what he's wanting people to see. They need to be divided. They need to be separated from these false teachers. And let me be crystal clear on this matter. So do we. We need to be divided and separate from the false teachers of our day, and they are legion. We are to be a people of the Word. Know the Word of God. Stand on the Word of God. Stand for the Word of God. And never compromise when it comes to the truth of God's Word, no matter what the liberals are screaming and no matter what society is declaring. We must stand on the Word of God. Amen? Now, if you are reading from the ESV, as we are, you will note that the text goes from verse 13 to 15. It skips verse 14. If you're reading in the NAS or the Home of Christian Standard, verse 14 is in brackets. If you're reading in the NIV, it leaves it out like the ESV and footnotes it. The New King James Version and the King James Version have it right in the text. And the reason the newer translations leave it out or put it in brackets is because verse 14 is not found in the earliest, most reliable manuscripts of Matthew's gospel that we have. And that tells us that it very likely was not in the original text, but was added at a later time by a zealous scribe who wanted it in there. So we're not going to discuss verse 14. We're going to move right to verse 15, because these are the words of the Lord. Take a look. He says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you travel across sea and land to make a single proselyte. And when he becomes a proselyte, you make him twice as much a child of hell as yourselves." He's not letting up any, is he? Here is our second woe, with our Lord again referring to the Jewish leadership as hypocrites. They go to great lengths to evangelize. This wasn't always the case, but at this time in history, they were going to great lengths to evangelize, to make converts. That's what a proselyte is. A proselyte is someone who is a Gentile who is converted to Judaism. They cross sea and land to convert someone to their form of Judaism, even if it's only one person. And our Lord is saying that they take great efforts to make converts. They go to much trouble. But in the end, their convert is twice as much a child of hell as they are. Here again, we find very harsh language coming from our Lord. Doesn't sound like the modern shampoo model Jesus, who's all love and peace, does it? Why does our Lord say these proselytes are twice the child of hell? It's a good question, isn't it? For two reasons. First, the scribes and the Pharisees had access to the Word of God, but they had developed their own system. The converts had only what the scribes and Pharisees taught them. So in effect, they were not converted to Judaism, but rather they were converted to Phariseeism. And secondly, many times someone who is converted to a faith from another faith or to a faith from no faith at all is much more zealous for that faith than someone who has grown up in a particular faith. There's much more zeal there. Now, I want you to note our Lord's phrase, child of hell. The NAS translates it, son of hell. Two things here quickly before we move on. First, I want you to note that our Lord has no problem referring to a place called hell. You see that? It is a real place where all of those who reject the Lord Jesus Christ will spend eternity. The Lord Jesus Christ speaks of hell more than anyone else in all of Scripture. Jesus is God. He's God, and he certainly knows what he is speaking. Our Lord confirms the existence of hell here as well as in other places. And secondly, note the term sons or child of hell. It is a quite common thing today to hear, "Oh, well, we're all God's children." Right? We've all heard that. We're all God's children. Well, that's a lie. That's a lie. We are all God's creation, but only those who are born again are God's children. No one is born a child of God. No one is born a child of God. They're born sinners. That's why Jesus says very clearly in John 3, "You must be born again." You must be born again. Not you should or you might be. You must be born again. The only children of God are those who have entered into the relationship with God through adoption by way of repentance and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Those are the children of God. No one else is a child of God. All of humanity are God's creation, but not children of God. Now, verses 16 and 17, as our Lord continues with this pronouncement of woe. "Woe to you, blind guides, who say, 'If anyone swears by the temple, it is nothing. But if anyone swears by the gold of the temple, he's bound by his oath.' You blind fools, for which is greater, the gold or the temple that has made the gold sacred?" This time our Lord calls the leadership blind guides and blind fools. Remember, this is in public. It's in public, a very public place. Quite a few people gathered around there, most likely. Very harsh language. They are blind to the truth of God. They are blind to the truth that's standing right before them and speaking to them. They are spiritually blind, and they are fools because it is obvious as to who Jesus is. It's obvious that he's the Messiah. It's obvious that he's God by what he does. Yet they reject him anyway. They're fools. All societies have a way of trying to make people keep their word, right? Sadly, that is something that is largely lacking today in our society, keeping your word. Everyone is pursuing their own well-being and will stop at nothing to achieve it, including lying and cheating and stealing, especially saying things that they have no intention of doing. If you want to see an example of this, turn on the TV. If you have your TV tuned into a news station, you are hearing lies. Those people are telling you what the management wants you to hear and believe. It is seldom the truth and the whole truth and nothing but the truth. Another great example is politicians are very leaders. It's easy to tell if a politician is lying. His lips are moving. They're lying. The word of a politician means nothing and should rarely be believed. And sadly, that is true of many regular folks as well. And that should hurt our hearts. Today in our society, we're not much different from our Lord's day. We used to swear an oath on the Bible when you went to court, right? But now you can swear an oath on the Quran, straight from the pit of hell, or all other sorts of things. But the principle remains the same. The point is to try to get people to be truthful and keep their word. A society cannot exist for any length of time when everyone is a liar. What's that say for the future of America? In our Lord's day, it had become custom to swear on things such as the temple, or as we'll see in a moment, the altar. But the scribes and the Pharisees had come up with a series of loopholes to escape having to keep their word. And our Lord gives the example. If a person were to swear by the temple, that oath was not binding. But if a person was to swear by the gold on the temple, then that one is binding. You have to keep that one. It's nothing more than political chicanery and completely absurd. And our Lord continues his condemnation and example in verses 18 through 20. Look at it. And you say, if anyone swears by the altar, it is nothing. But if anyone swears by the gift that is on the altar, he's bound by his oath. You blind man, for which is greater, the gift or the altar that makes the gift sacred? So whoever swears by the altar swears by it and by everything on it. This is the same issue as swearing on the temple or the gold on the temple. The scribes and Pharisees had said that if an oath is made by the altar, no big deal. But if it were made by the gift on the altar, well, then it's binding. Surely you can see the absurdity in all of this. It's absurd. It was merely nonsensical jargon to allow them to be as sinful and dishonest as they could, while all the while appearing to be holy and righteous. And our Lord is calling it out. Now verses 21 and 22. And whoever swears by the temple swears by it and by him who dwells in it. And whoever swears by heaven swears by the throne of God and by him who sits upon it. Here we have more of the same as our Lord corrects their sinful, devious thinking. There is no excuse for breaking an oath. There's no excuse for breaking an oath. Jesus is telling the scribes and Pharisees, as well as the people who are standing there in a temple with them, that an oath is an oath, and there are no loopholes. Our Lord is pointing out the glaring hypocrisy and dishonesty of those very people who were supposed to be teaching and leading the people in the things of God. Imagine that. Those were their spiritual leaders. In our first installment of three of the seven woes our Lord pronounces on the Jewish leadership, we find him condemning the fact that they are slamming the figurative door in eternal life to eternal life in the faces of those who are seeking God. We find him condemning the fact that the leadership is actively making converts, but rather than converting them to God, the scribes and Pharisees are converting them to Pharisaism. And we find our Lord condemning the fact that they have made a mockery out of swearing an oath. He's letting them have it. And in each of these things, we can find application to our own lives. We can dig out biblical principles here. First, are we making it easy for people to come to know the Lord, or more difficult? Are we making it easy for people to come to know the Lord, or are we making it more difficult? Another way, I guess, of saying this is, do our lives reflect our faith? When someone looks at us when we're outside of church, they say, there's something different about that person. Do you reflect Christ? Every day, not just in church. Or are you just like everyone else in the sinful, dying world? I know people who profess to be believers, but if they were brought before a court of law, there isn't enough evidence in their life to convict them of being a Christian. You'd never know. Is that us? When we come into contact with someone, are they closer to coming to faith or further away? Or how about this? Seeing as how I've alluded to some political stuff today, when we're seeking to convert someone, are we trying to convert them to our way of thinking? Or are we trying to convert them to the Lord Jesus Christ for the glory of God? And we all think we think rightly, don't we? But do we think biblically? Secondly, when we say we are going to do something, do we do it? This seems pretty simple, doesn't it? If you say you're going to do something, do you do it? Is your word good? Can you be counted on? Every vow that you take and every promise that you make is before God. There's nothing you say, there's nothing you do, there's nothing that you think about that's not before God. So then when you say you're going to do something, or you say you're going to be somewhere at a certain time, do what you say you're going to do and be where you say you're going to be when you say you're going to be there. Because it's all in the presence of God. Nothing that you do, nothing that you think about is not in the presence of God. And finally, I want you to consider the intensity and the ferocity with which our Lord condemns these false teachers. I want you to note that in the text. He is ferocious against these guys. And there is no greater danger in our world today, nor has there ever been, than that of false teachers. I want you to see what Dr. MacArthur has to say. He says, that is why the greatest battle in the world is not against communism or humanism or secularism or social justice. The greatest battle by far is the battle for men's souls, a battle which could be lost even if somehow all those other battles were won. You see that? The great challenge of the church in our day is to clearly and boldly articulate God's truth and just as clearly and boldly to expose Satan's falsehoods. We must know and stand on the truth of God's word, and we must call out and point out those who are teaching and promoting error. The very souls of men depend on it. It's easy for us to get wrapped up in good causes. It is. Causes such as defeating abortion and all kinds of other social issues. And mind you, I'm not saying that we should not engage in these types of issues. But make no mistake, they are not the main issue. They're not the main issue. Did you know that someone can be vehemently against abortion and still not know the Lord? Did you know that? Did you know that there are many people today who oppose abortion but are headed to hell? That's a fact. However, if we focus our attention on reaching our community, our friends, our neighbors, our family, with the gospel of Jesus Christ, we're going to kill two birds with one stone. We're actively participating in the expansion of God's kingdom like we're commanded to do. And those who are truly in God's kingdom, for example, don't murder babies. And the same is true for every social issue we face today. The true biblical gospel of Jesus Christ fixes them all. Fixes them all. And all of that begins with you. Do you know the Lord? Do you know the Lord? Have you realized that you're not good? Have you realized that you can't be good in and of yourself? You can't be good enough to enter into God's kingdom on your own. You can't be. Have you then repented of your sin and trusted in Christ to put you into right standing with God? Have you done that? If you have not, then I call on you today to do so. I implore you to repent and trust Christ today, right where you sit. Do it now. Do it before it's too late. Behold, today is the day of salvation. Behold, now is the accepted time. Repent and trust in Christ today, and you will be saved. Let's pray. Father, we are thankful that we can turn to your word and we can see how the Lord Jesus Christ gives us an example of how serious the issue of false teachers truly is. How dangerous it is to be off by just a little bit. If we're off just a little bit here, we end up way off at the other end. God, help us to confront lies when we see them, to stand on the word of God, to stand on your truth, to lovingly share the truth with others, not condemning, not in a judgmental fashion, but lovingly. Help us to love you more and to love others more. God, if we just do that, everything else takes care of itself. And Father, I pray for those who are among us today or listening online, friends and family, who don't know you, Lord, we plead for their souls. We ask that you save them, that you would draw them to yourself for your glory. We ask that your will be done in all things. It's through Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Ushers, can I get you to come forward, please? Grace that taught
May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. May the God of peace be with you all. Amen. Y'all have a great week. Happy Mother's Day again. We'll see you next week. Go serve your King.
My chains are gone.